Yeah, leave the kangaroo alone.
So this is just a non-working model of the emergency wide field array. So this is actually in use up in the Murchison Desert, but they're currently upgrading it with the square kilometre array. It's okay, there's no power to it.
Oh, no, it's okay, so we're turning on anyway.
But they take radio waves. Okay.
Yeah. It's a trial.
Very cool. So the big one that we're building is square kilometre, and the longest part is the Christmas trees. They're quite tall. And I reckon they'll be up and running by 2028, 2030, something like that. Okay, guys, I'm going to bring you into this big dome here.
Philip. Mm. Oh, I like the farm in here.
So this is our largest telescope that we use for the public. It's a 30-inch mirror telescope. It's a reflector.
So another telescope.
Okay. And the rule of thumb is that the larger the aperture, the more light bring in, which means the further you can see. So we were using this to look at the galaxies. And quite often there's a couple at the moment that we look at. But last night, because of the cloud cover, we were actually using this to look at the moon.
Last night?
We were looking inside the craters of the moon with this thing. So it looks a bit IKEA, but there is a small computer. And it has electric motors on it. And once you've done your two-star alignment, this is before you start the evening, basically you point it at a star, you get in the middle of the crosshairs, and then you're feeding the coordinates, and then you take it to another star. And then once it goes to the two-star star, and you've got the side of the time in here, it knows where everything else is. And then you just have to drive it, and then see what it's going to do.
So it's actually, you can see through...
That's what we have set now. So you're actually putting an eyepiece through here, and it's actually quite high up.
Oh.
And this dome rotates around, and you just try to get what you're looking at with it. So one of the favourites is the Tarantula Nebula, which is in the Large Magellanic Cloud, which is a small galaxy, a dwarf galaxy next to ours, which is about 180,000 light years away.
I only know the small telescope, but this is amazing telescopes.
So the next one that we use, and we've got two of these. So the one that's similar to this. So this
is more modern.
Yeah. So this is all you have to do with this one, apart taking the cover off, is switch it on. It then takes GPS readings, and then once it's got the location sorted out, you just have to key in the object that you want to look at using the keyboard here. You've got a Mars, you want to have a look at Aldebaran, you want to look at this, you want to look at that, and then it will automatically go to it. And the only thing that we would have to do is open up the shutters.
The shutters, open up. Oh!
And then rotate the dome around.
Oh!
Sorry.
This is a...
Now, you look at this telescope and you think, well, it's not very big. This is a Cassier grain telescope, which means that the light comes in, hits a mirror at the bottom, hits another mirror at the top, and comes back out through the end here. So it's the equivalent of a telescope three times its size. So this is a 14-inch, and we have a bigger 16-inch that we also use. Now the next one I'm going to take you to there are two telescopes. One is the one that's really, really old, and more modern day one, which you don't even have to get out of your bed to go and use it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, please.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Hey.
Come on.
Put a pencil, Philip. Philip. Put a pencil.
What's in this one? These are portable telescopes, yeah? You come inside here.
Tattoo.
Hello.
Hello.
So this is our favorite telescope.
So you can open the shutter as well.
Yeah, of course. So the reason we bought this telescope is that when they bought the original two telescopes, we're talking about the one in the foyer and the astrograph, which I'll take you to later. So John Forrest, who was the premier of WA at the time, he promised the people first that they could come and view the stars through the big telescope, which upset the astronomer because he couldn't get his work done. So they bought this one for public use. And since 1910, when it was installed, it's been for use by the public ever since. So you're looking at something that's 110 years old. The thing about this telescope is that we took this to Broome, to Luar, for the measure of the bending of the light around the sun. So as Joe may have mentioned, everything was boxed away, taken by ship to Broome, and then brought to shore, and then they went to the Wild Desert with a donkey. We weren't the only ones, so you had the astronomical societies from the UK, from the States, from Singapore, and they all set up their telescopes. And the idea was that when the moon passes in front of the sun, you can see the stars that are directly behind the sun. And the thing is that through Einstein's theory, is that a large mass actually bends light. So what you're actually seeing is a star that's actually behind it, but it's, because of the bending of light, it's actually, you can see it visibly. So you can appear, you're seeing this, but it's actually over here.
Oh.
Okay.
It's like bend, like your eyes when you, what you said, a corner.
Yes. So what they did was that they waited 6 months. So the planet Earth is on the other side of the sun, and you're looking at the same stars, and you take a photograph of that, and you overlay the two photographs, and you can see that the star positions have moved. And that basically proved Einstein's theory that light bends with the gravitational mass. And the reason they came to Well Al in the first place was that originally there was a full eclipse off the coast of Africa, but it was cloudy that day, so we only got partial photographs. So they waited 3 years to do it again in Australia. This is everybody's favourite, but it's not everybody's favourite to use. It gives fantastic images, but this is a fully manual telescope, so you need to know your night sky. There's no computers attached to this, so you need to locate the object you're looking at.
Otherwise,
you lock it in, you can switch the rotor on, and then it will follow the star or the object as the Earth rotates. This one here is a fully modern day version. It's 10 years old now. But this one is run by, it's an Alcock telescope, but it's run by Skynet. So it's run by a company called Skynet. And Skynet has about 40 or 50 of these telescopes dotted around the world. So if you're living in Northern Europe or Northern America, and you want to look at the night skies in the south, and you don't want to travel, you book time for Skynet, and they will allocate you 30 minutes on the telescope. And then you've got full control of the telescope, doors will open in the middle of the night. This telescope can be then programmed to look at particular
objects.
You've got a camera on the back of here, with a filter wheel, and download the images. So basically, this is the new way of doing
that. That's the question.
So we've got quite a few astrophotographers and who are helping us, and they prefer the old-fashioned way of submitting cameras and stuff. I mean, today you can buy, for $4,000, you can buy a device that sits in your back garden, and it can take images almost as good as a proper astrophotographer, depending on, of course, the clouds of the night sky. But it's not the same.
Get away from the city lights.
But it's like, you know, a photographer using, you can use a phone.
We can use just a camera, but with a big zoom in like that. So actually, all the telescope, each telescope has different function, or in particular times to use?
Yes. Uh-huh. So for instance, you can have somebody in the States booking this camera, this telescope from, say, 2:30 in the morning to 3, and then you can have somebody in Germany going from 3 o'clock to 3:30, and so on, and that's how it's, basically there's a schedule of use. It's not different to the really big telescopes. So I follow an astrophysicist in the UK from Cambridge, and she gets a lot of time with the big telescopes in the Atacama Desert in Chile. And they gave, they give her full night to do her research. Mm. But again, they give a lot of time to different researchers. Mm. And that's what we want to do with the big telescope.
That might be the best.
Can we go to the next?
Yes.
So,
relax, okay?
We're going to move across here to...
Can we go to the green one?
Not yet. That's
not. Oh, it's moving out.